All right. Good evening, everyone, and a very warm welcome to the second day of Towards the Policy Framework for Indian Science Communication. Today, we are going to be discussing themes like ecosystem and training in science communication, as well as the ideas and the notions of inclusivity, diversity, equity, and accessibility in science communication, and how we can achieve those things. My name is Siddharth Kankaria. I am a science communication outreach manager at NCBS Bangalore. And today, me and Vanshika Singh, who is a from SPF, will be your facilitators for the day. Before we begin and introduce the event, I would like to call upon Dr. Shagun Bashra to set the context of what we are doing and why we're doing it. So, Dr. Shagun, please.
Hi, thanks, Siddharth. Thanks, everyone, for joining. Thanks for your time. And I'm not going to repeat anything what you don't know already. I'll just try to say a few things for people who weren't in previous conversation that we had with respect to STIP 2020 or science communication, let's say, with respect to this particular policy. We had two events on science communication dedicated conversations where we felt that the 2 hour long panel discussion wasn't enough to go into the details of a lot of let's say the know-hows and hows and how to do things, not only at the policy level but also at the program level. Because a lot of, the devil lies in the details, as the legend says. I think the devil discussion is something that Siddharth and Vanshika and others came up with. Let's have a branch event to go in detail and to come up with something more tangible and outcome driven. So I'm really glad that all these wonderful individuals can spare this time and join this conversation and come up with some solid recommendations. So the idea here is to have completely decentralized conversation. This is not a government platform, a government conversation. We want to have it more and more inclusive. And this is one of the example events that we have in a way to say that this is completely a branch decentralized event where people think that this is something is missing. So we go ahead and start having that as a conversation. That being said, we encourage every other topic also to be discussed as extensively as science communication, the way we are having it here. And also I just want to add one more sentence about how these deliberations are going to help us in this particular policy, STIP 2020, also beyond that policy. So whatever is going to come out of this discussion yesterday, we had a very detailed discussion on two other aspects. And today we are going to have some of them as well. And whatever is going to come out, we are going to put out as a policy framework, as a draft framework with recommendations, which will have endorsement from people, contributions from people who are participating today and who participated yesterday, but also from people who could not join us but are ready to give inputs through email. And after this event, read out those recommendations and endorse and make some corrections and changes. So that will be taken for this policy. But beyond the policy is what is interesting, which is even if this policy is not able to capture everything that is going to come out in that detail, we would like to continue this conversation and to come up with a very comprehensive framework, which is very, very India specific, let's say, so that we could achieve something beyond what we are having as just a discussion. With that, I'll hand it over to Siddharth and Vanshika to conduct the excellent way the way they did it yesterday also, and looking forward to the conversations. Yeah. Thank you so much, Siddharth.
Thank you so much, Shagun, for setting the context of why we are doing it and how we came about to doing this. Before I, go ahead and introduce the event and how it came about, I would just like to say that this event is being organized by Science Policy Forum, of which Shagun is a co-founder, and the SciComm Sci Club. So just to tell you a little bit about the SciComm Sci Club, I mean, it's my, pitch to, introduce everyone to the club. So the SciComm Sci Club is a space for networking, dialogue, and discussions that is centered around the science of science communication. So the abbreviation SciComm Sci actually stands for the science of science communication. And the club brings together science communication practitioners, researchers, and enthusiasts to together collectively learn about evidence-based ways of doing science communication, especially so in the Indian context, right? So about this event, we've had science communication in India is really coming to the fore in the last few years, and we've had multiple public events where we have discussed what is the state of science communication in India, what needs to be done to improve it. Two notable events in that regard were the brainstorming meeting organized by the office of the PSA in January 2020, out of which many of the people attending today were also part of it. And there was another event, which was the STIP 2020 Across the Table panel discussion. I also see panelists from that discussion here today with us. So these were two notable events, but I think for the lack of time, these events came up with a lot of brilliant ideas and suggestions for what could be done, but I felt like we couldn't really get into the nitty-gritties and the details of how to go about doing these things. And so this event that we've organized today is partly in response to kind of having an open discussion as to how we can achieve those kind of ideas that we had set in those previous two meetings. So today's event is not meant to be a panel discussion. It's meant to be an open discussion where everybody pitches in with their experience, their expertise, their background, and their shared, you know, experience of working in the science community. Sorry, I think there's an echo. Right. So the event is meant to be a very open and informal discussion, and we have a set of discussion prompts that we have shared with everybody who's attending today. So we'll be using those prompts as a way to, you know, segue into or introduce into, talk about these points and collectively deliberate on, you know, what is the best way of achieving these things, and also detail the nuances and details of, you know, how to go about doing these things, right? At the end of this event, we are hoping to kind of create a sort of a comprehensive draft policy document, which we will be sharing for public feedback. And after we receive feedback from everybody, including all of you guys, we're hoping that we could, you know, polish up that document and feed it into the STIP 2020 policy drafting process, as Shagun mentioned. And so that's the aim and agenda of why we're doing this event. That being said, the conversation that we initiate today is meant to be a seed. And it can, of course, go on for much longer. And we hope that it will go on much longer, because we cannot really achieve all of that, you know, what we're planning to do in the span of 2 hours. But we really hope that this is a conversation starter and we kind of go ahead and have more discussions on these topics and also, you know, get to know each other better. Right. So without any further ado, I think I'll hand over the mic to Vanshika, who will, you know, talk about the housekeeping rules for today. Over to you, Vanshika.
Sure, thanks Siddharth, and thanks Shagun for setting the stage so perfectly for today. So just for everybody's convenience, I'll lay out some housekeeping rules. This entire session will be recorded and will later be put up on our Science Policy Forum YouTube channel. For the purpose of engaging with us, you can use the chat box to raise your hand or type in your comment, and we'll make sure that we take it up to the best of our abilities here. And throughout the session, please keep yourself muted and your videos turned off for the sake of the bandwidth. And in case you face any difficulty in any sort of technical or any sort of technical glitch, you can always try and re-enter through the Teams meeting link, and or also try and switch between the browser or the app. So let's move on. And before we begin with today's session, in the interest of those who could not be present with us yesterday, I'd briefly touch upon what transpired in our discussions. So we talked about not letting institutional affiliations be the sole criteria to secure funding in SciComm. We also debated on who should really be making the case for SciComm. Is it the scientist whose research is being communicated? Is it the professional SciCommer? Or should we bring in like completely third perspectives from journalists for an all-inclusive process? We also debated whether putting scientists in chairs for national bodies will reinforce hierarchy and what should be the way forward. For a complete unroll of the live Twitter thread, you can always visit the Science Policy Forum and SciComm Sci social media handles. Now, collating all our deliberations from yesterday and moving on to today's discussion, one aspect of building the right ecosystem to enable SciComm is a formal mentor-mentee relationship. And in my experience, it's been really sort of enriching for me as a person who's actively engaging in SciComm to sort of go around and see what people can mentor me on a personal basis as well. And a lot of people in the room today are present here who I know in person as well and who have mentored me personally. But I do believe that there is a need for formalizing this kind of a mentor-mentee relationship as well. And current bodies that are enabling SciComm in India impart SciComm as a discipline rather than an active practice or an on-ground sort of training in SciComm. So the question that I now open to the room is whether the status quo should be maintained in SciComm through informal mentee-mentor relationships, or such liaisons should be formalized. And if yes, then how do we go about doing that? So this is open to the room, and anybody who'd like to pitch in with their thoughts can type in the chat box and we'll take the comments.
You could also raise your hand, but I think there is some technical issue with the raise hand feature. So in case you're not able to see the raise hand feature, don't worry. You could just type in the chat box and we'll give you a chance to speak. But if you can see the raise hand feature, feel free to use that either, right?
Sure.
Thank you. Right. So while we are waiting for people to, oh, I see Karishma. Karishma, would you like to take the mic? Thank you.
Yeah, I'll unmute, but I won't put my video on, because then it slows down. Is that okay?
Sure.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah. So coming to your original point of scientists doing science communication or, you know, non-scientists doing it, I think it's possibly a combination of both would be effective. But someone correctly brought out that communication in science is not only your research. It is also communicating multiple things to the public. So it's not a research publicity that is going on when scientists take on roles as outreach communicators. So it should be communicating a range of topics relevant to society. And the second thing I bring about is about funding. Look, usually scientists who do this will do this in their personal capacity. It makes sense to build funding platforms that go to the scientist and not the institute. Because once you go to the institute, again, you are stuck with how to get out the money, you know, the whole three quotation, PR, PO, everything that we deal with in science on an everyday basis. Whereas we can, if the funding amounts are smaller, we can bypass them if you trust your scientists and you're able to fund them directly with answerability from them. So I think those are my few points. Thank you. I'll mute.
Thank you. I think we can take TVB's comments up next.
Yeah.
So would you
can
please
I share a slide if that is okay?
Sure, sir, please.
Go yeah, ahead. Sure. I think, no. I think I'm sharing
we
the
can
wrong.
See.
No, I want to, just a minute, I'm just getting, are you seeing my slide sponsored? I'm just a bit.
We see a notes document, sir.
No. Then I'll get them off so that they won't. This is what I want. Sorry for this fumbling. I suppose this happens. Yeah. Can we now see?
Yes,
yeah. Okay. This is something that I presented in my presentation, but I would like to once again emphasize on this because when I read through the points which were circulated, I get a feeling that whenever we talk about science communication, we are only in one quadrant of this four quadrant. Okay, so let me just take a minute to explain this. I'm sorry if I'm taking too much of time, but I hope in this freewheeling discussion, we can spend some time on this. In a way, one can look at this four quadrants in this way that, for example, the first quadrant is dissemination. That is, within quotes, the science communicators know something to be told, and they are saying in an interesting way, in an appealing way, etc., etc. Okay, so essentially, like science journalism, science center, radio and television shows, most of them, okay, are of this kind. If you are going to look at research, you will be looking at two kinds, whether how much we are able to reach. Second is how much people are able to understand. Okay. So dissemination essentially assumes that your audience is only a receiver.
Sure.
Yeah. Okay. But whereas one can look at a second quadrant where there is a dialogue, meaning that audience have certain preferences, audience have certain views. So here we are not only talking about the pure science, which is laboratory science, but we are talking about where the science meets the society. Okay, so that aspect comes in. So there are lots of such activities in India one can talk about. I have just mentioned one aspect here, but doesn't matter. So there is a dialogue aspect. The third aspect is participation aspect. Like, for example, the larger section, not only the communicator, but the communicated also are participating in jointly creating the meaning, creating the content, creating knowledge together. Something like, for example, citizen science is one good example of that. Lastly, there is also an ambivalent corner where people have conspiracy theory, pseudoscience, they are also to be addressed. Yeah. So in this four quadrant, if we keep our view only on dissemination, unfortunately, I think our policy will be very short-sighted. We need to think beyond the dissemination mode. This is one thing that I would like to emphasize once again, because I see it again and again. I mean, maybe I'm wrong. If I'm wrong, I'm happy for that. I will be happy to be wrong in this. Oh, okay. Now coming to the points that was made in the note which is circulated. 1 minute, maybe then again come back to some other point. Okay. I think if you are going to talk about a training ecosystem, we need to also evaluate what went on earlier. Okay. There have been a lot of interesting experiments which have happened in India. If you are oblivious to it, then we will be making a big mistake. So I would just put two such interesting thing before you. One was the brainchild of NCSTC, National Council for Science and Technology Communication. So in all over the country, they chose something close to about 20 to 25 universities, which used to offer science communication program of various kinds. You know, I mean, some of them were full-time science communication program, some of them are a science communication program which was attached to a journalism program. So there were various models within that also, which means that in the formal education itself, the science communication plays a role. In fact, if you look at some of the key people in science communication today, like T.V. Jain, etc., they all studied in one of these courses. That's just a point. With this, I will stop for a short thing. I mean, maybe other points, I'll take it up later. Thank you.
Sure. Thank you for setting the tone, sir. So we have Priyanka Dasgupta. She's a friend of mine from Imperial College London, and she's pursuing science communication course there. And she'd like to sort of take this up, take this discussion up about mentor-mentee relationships. And Priyanka, would you please come in and share?
I can leave the camera off if that helps. But yeah, I think there were some very valid points that Dr. TVVA, sorry, I'm just seeing the abbreviated form on my computer here. But I think he presented some very valid points about dissemination and dialogue. And like that reminded me of this essential part of dialogue being even there in the mentor-mentee relationship. So that so the reason that I brought that up is that there's a very famous critical pedagogy of the oppressed by Freire, Paulo Freire, and it speaks about hierarchy of when we're teaching. So what before this he also spoke about in dissemination, that when we're usually disseminating information, when the teacher or say the mentor is explaining it to the mentee, it's usually a one-way route. And that sort of takes a hierarchy, and that leads to an unequitable position in science or science communication, let's say. But when there's dialogue, it allows the person who is mentoring to not just think about the mentee, but also think with them. And I think that's very essential. So when we are talking about mentor-mentee relationship, the fact that you said that it needs to be formalized or let it be informal, I think a lot of people, including myself, have just gone, walked up to these stalwarts who've been really great people in their industries and sort of asked them to mentor me. And they've done so very, very helpfully, in fact. Right. But I do think there's a necessity for it to be formalized, not in the sense to increase the rigor and let's say to increase the hoops to jump through, but I think it needs to be formalized in a sense that it is recognized, that it can be then recognized by different places, and the mentee can then use that as a way to vouch for one's accomplishments. And I think that's interesting. Yeah.
Thank you, Priyanka.
Thanks for sharing that insight, Priyanka. I just want to add one point to what TVV said. I think this debate about using the deficit or dissemination model versus using a dialogic or more participatory model is a debate that's being happening across the globe in multiple countries in multiple contexts. And it's very interesting that initially it was said that, you know, the dissemination or deficit model needs to be replaced by the dialogic model. But right now it's coming back a full circle, and people are saying that the deficit model also has certain merits and certain applications in very specific contexts. So, for example, in India, if you think this is a term that I like to use, there is a lot of need to do need-based science communication, which is like, which when you're talking about things like, you know, nutrition and health and, you know, sanitation, these kind of basic necessities, there is some amount of need for doing dissemination-based science communication. But at the same time, there's also a huge scope for, and which is sort of underrepresented in India, is the need for doing curiosity-based science communication, which you talk about, you know, science for the sake of curiosity or for the sake of generating interest, and not because you're trying to disseminate a particular fact or concept, right? So I feel personally that there is a space and a time and sort of a scope for having both, sort of a mixed methods approach. So that's just one comment I wanted to make. And another thing, I can see in the chat box, there are a lot of people saying, talking about the NSTSC course and what happened to it. I just want to give an example of a science journalism course run by Anil Anandaswamy. And I can say that a lot of people attending today have actually been products of that course. And that course has actually had a very long-term impact in terms of creating resources or human resources for science communication in India. So I think we need to think about what is it that we can learn from such examples, and what is it that we can learn from examples which have not worked out previously as well, and what can we do to improve it. So that's kind of keeping in line with what do we need to do to ensure training and certification in science communication in the Indian context, right? So would anyone like to comment on this? I see Dr. KP Madhu making a lot of comments. Madhu, would you like to sort of comment here?
Yes, I have a strong feeling that after 30 years of NCSTC courses in many places, we have not produced adequate number of people, and that it was primarily because of targeting the wrong group. We should target people who can read a paper and understand it, minimum requirement. And then if you train them in short, compact workshops, it will have more impact in the long run. This is my humble suggestion, that we train people who are adequately equipped already. Otherwise, we would be training kindergarten schools. We should not have SciComm courses, please. So no BSc, no certificate courses for plus two level, no degree courses for SciComm, no mass communication or master's courses in science communication without having adequate background in science. Without content, we cannot communicate anything. This is the first this thing. Then the other is how long it should be, how big it should be, how short can it be, etc. For example, Wellcome Trust trains the same target group as I do, but at much higher levels in terms of their capacity. And it's a two-day course. I do an eight-day course with 1 month pre and 1 month post workshop interactions, so that I can mentor them and I can get them to write. So a follow-up is necessary, definitely. There was a point about goals of science communication. There are two ways of looking at the goals. What are we trying to do? What should we achieve when you look at it? One way is to say, our media should contain 10 to 15% of coverage of science. This is one way of saying. Many people have pointed that out, that the percentage of coverage is very small. We should increase it. This is one way of looking at it. Let me look at it from a different point of view. We have about 1,50,000 papers by Indian scientists every year, 1,50,000 as per Scopus, maybe 80 or 90,000 as per Web of Science. Can we have an attitude saying that we'll have 1% coverage or reporting of these results, scientific results, which were funded by the Indian government, which the Indian citizen should know? 1%, that's about 1,500 papers. we are not able to test that. So can we target saying that this year, 2020, can we have 1,500 papers being reported in various media? It is not that media is not interested. Media does not have the capability to report. So can we press this up? This would change the not only science communication environment in the country, it'll also change the way science is funded, because people, the members of the parliament, the MLAs should understand what science is being done. If they do not know, let alone the Kisan in Chhattisgarh or anything, at least these people should know so that the funding for science happens. Funding for science is never stopped at any ministry level. If we can assure that, we would have done a great deal. I would also suggest that those people who are into training, like Gubbi Labs is training, Wellcome Trust is training, Current Science is training, Anand Swami through NCBS has been training. Can we bring all these people together, look at the curriculum, look at the methodologies, so that this can be percolated, we can have more trainers. We need more trainers. If you want to cover 1,500 papers, which is only 1%, even then we need more trainers in the country. Can we come together in one platform and share the resources, share the methodologies that we use, and the strategies that we use in training? That's all from my side. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Madhu. I think that's a very valid point about getting together trainers, because I think a lot of people have been trying to reinvent the wheel independently, and they've all been trying to do a lot of work, but I think there is a huge opportunity for people to come together and, you know, work together. So that's a point well taken. So this also brings us to our the second discussion prompt. So far we talked about the vertical transfer of knowledge, which is training science communicators in the skills that are required. But there's also an important scope for having the horizontal transfer of knowledge, which is having, you know, as Madhu pointed out, you know, getting the trainers together to talk to each other, but also getting scientists, artists, different media people, different kinds of science communicators together, because even if someone does not have a science background, they can still assist someone with a science background to communicate the science better, right? So there's also a huge scope for, you know, the horizontal transfer of knowledge. So while we think about this, I think Ritika had a question which she had pointed her hand up. Ritika, would you like to ask a question?
So I had a question, because you mentioned the deficit model that it's making a comeback. And so that's what my question is, because the model assumes a one-way transmission. Whoever it is I'm talking to, they don't know, I know more, and so I must inform, fill that hole in there, whatever, knowledge. But I guess I'm not seeing what the plus side of that is, because, see, the thing where I think that why pseudoscience has the up, always, where actual science is always trailing behind pseudoscience, that pseudoscience gives a definitive, this is right, how it is, and the virus hangs around in your throat. You know, so if we do the same thing, how are we addressing a problem? We're just, don't listen to that, listen to me. And it's just, you know, instead of going about evidence-based, instead of people wanting and giving that, ask questions, we're just replacing this, what they think.
I completely agree with you, and I think the demerits of the deficit model have been criticized and discussed to great extent. I'm not defending the deficit model saying that we should adopt it. I'm just saying that there is a space and a time and a scope for incorporating it within more dialogic ways of communicating, because in some places, in some contexts, there is an example, and I don't really want to get into it right now, but I think we can take this conversation off. I can share some resources with you which very recently have been published, which talks about that, you know, they also mentioned that how it's very difficult to get rid of a deficit model, and there are certain reasons behind why, despite having a discourse over getting rid of the deficit model, we have not been able to achieve that. And there are very specific reasons which also indirectly point at the fact that there are certain merits to using it in certain contexts. So I mean, I'll just say that and leave it for now. Right. So I think.
Can I ask a follow-up, actually?
Sure.
So since we're talking about addressing the SciComm in the training period, when people are in school or in college and so on, so isn't the way we teach science is also kind of like this deficit model? You don't know, and I will tell you. And isn't that the reason that science education suffers? And isn't that why people who are science graduates so, you know, fall for BS?
I think that's a very valid point, and we have a much larger discussion on the role of science communication within science education. So can I hold that thought? Can you hold that thought for a while, and we'll come back to it today. I mean, we have definitely, this is a part of our plan. So hold on. Thank you so much. I think Divika had a point to make. Divika, would you like to reiterate what you've mentioned in the chat box?
I'm assuming you meant Divita, but that's okay. I was just saying that because now KP Maru was talking about some courses and the value what all course material is available. I think one of the ways could be having online courses, because even in the young institutes, like many ICERs and even like IITs, I think more and more people are availing for online courses. So that could be one of the very quick ways if people do get together and get something like solid about and compile resources, even in science communication. I think that could be a really useful way of getting people like who are in the master's program and actually get introduced science communication to them. Yeah.
Right. Right, Divita. Thanks. And I think Nazia sort of resonates with the same line of thought. And Nazia, would you like to come in and give us our thoughts? So Nazia writes that including basic SciComm as a part of syllabus in schools will allow to sort of early on start with the training of SciComm. And Nazia? I guess she's having some issues in unmuting herself. So maybe we can take the conversation forward.
Right. While Nazia is trying to join in, can we move to the next point? So does anybody have any comment on how do we enable horizontal transfer of knowledge? So the vertical transfer of knowledge in the sense that, you know, having courses and, you know, teaching science communication skills is one thing. How do we enable more crosstalk between different experts in different fields and different experts in different forms of communication? Does anybody have a comment on that regard?
Priyanka says she could start, so maybe we could invite her. Priyanka, would you like to unmute and speak?
Yeah, so, is Nazia coming in? A joy to meet you. Okay, so I'll just start on the horizontal transfer thing, and I think it goes back to this crosstalk and about where people are funded from. So I've seen a lot of institutions try and garner a lot of communication networks within themselves. So there would be a communication network prompting up in North, and they would try and attempt to form a community of science communicators. And then there would be a simultaneous community spurting from the South or West or East. But the fact remains that there is always an attempt, like every year or so, I think there's an attempt to form a network where all the contacts are rolled in and made into one common network. But I think the problem or the major limitation remains that everyone is doing that individually. And there's a need to kind of, while there are resources being pooled in, even that is being done in very diversified and non-integrated sources. So it kind of becomes a repetition of the same thing instead of it becoming an additive to each other. So,
right. Creating communication loops, smaller local ones, is definitely one way to enable what we are trying to do here. So, sure. Point well taken. Thank you, Priyanka.
You're welcome. I mean, yeah, that just maybe to start more conversations on this. Yeah.
Sure. So that maybe we can take up the next agenda prompt now.
Sure. Right. So coming back to Ritika's point about science education. So there is the first aspect is about, you know, designing courses for science communication itself. But if you move away from that for a bit and think about what is the role of science communication to assist the pedagogy sector or the science education sector. So science education in Indian schools has a lot of features, but there is a huge scope and role for, you know, in using insights and methods from science communication practice to incorporate it within the teaching and the education of science within our school system, right? So would anybody like to comment on that and how we can use science communication insights and practices to kind of feed into the science education sector? I see Nazia is back. Nazia, can you speak? Are you able to unmute yourself? Hello. Manasvi, do you want to speak? Yes.
Hello. So I am an aspiring communicator and I just finished my undergrad degree. And a lot of my friends... Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, Manasvi.
Yeah, okay, yeah. So a lot of my friends who are science students in biotechnology don't know about science communication. And I only got to know because of my own perception. But what I found that in our universities and everything, we have English courses. In like undergrad, we have a compulsory English course. But instead of science teachers, students being taught stuff like British literature or American literature from 20-100 years ago, which has no relevance to us right now, either in philosophy or our current ideologies, it would be more interesting for us to have more SciComm related work, more like stuff like Leelavati's Daughters, different books, and that inspires us science students to do other things. And it would also be a good segue to SciComm, so more students would be introduced to that. Yeah.
Right.
Also, it could be added in 11th and 12th, people who take PCMB and, science students, instead of them having the same curriculum as other English students, they should have a English science-based curriculum. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Right. I see Shanti has made a point. Shanti, would you like to, speak up and share your thoughts on this?
Yeah. Thank you. So I was thinking that most of our training programs, masters and PhD, they don't really have a dedicated session or course related to communication as such. That being said, this is a general issue for most of our education and not just starting suddenly at the master's level. So how do you communicate with each other effectively? This is something I feel that the Indian education system hasn't entirely incorporated into its curriculum. Now, we cannot overhaul the entire system, but to address it at the master's and bachelor's and PhD levels, one could have these researcher development programs specifically, where there is a dedicated program to help researchers. Right now, it happens in cases where the PIs or the mentors take this interest upon themselves. And that way, it cannot be in an organized manner. And it can happen, and it happens only in anecdotal circumstances. Mm-hmm. So this acknowledgement that communication is a very important component of practice, of the practice of science, I think should come from a higher, overall level, and not only at individual level. I'm not discrediting any of individual, efforts, which are really very commendable, but for it to have a wider impact, it needs to have institutional support, it needs to have government support is what I think.
Yeah. Right, and since we talk about training, yeah, Shanti, please complete this.
Yeah, I'm good.
Okay, all right. I think we have Nazia online.
Yeah, I hope you can hear me now.
Yes, we can.
Okay, fine.
No, Nazia.
I think so many people have already touched upon many points I wanted to make, but there's one point that I want to add is we are actually trying to create SciComm different from communication. I think so. Communication in general should be a part of the curriculum, and then at least you know how to communicate any subject that you want to, be it like mass communication or journalism. So once you get those skills of communication, you can always go into science communication. So I think so, maybe at the school level, if SciComm cannot be included as part of the syllabus, more of communication skills can be taught to the students, because I think so many of us, especially in India, we lack the confidence or we lack the skills to be able to present anything that we want to say on a public platform. So that's the point that I wanted to make, that we should not talk only, we should talk more in terms of communication being included at the school level, and then SciComm can be introduced later.
Right, and I think Debarshini Siddharth also has a point on this regard, and we could call her in and she could elaborate.
Sure. Debarshini, would you like to add? Sorry, are we calling on Debarshini? Yes.
Yeah. Hi, everybody. So really, thanks a lot to Siddharth for having brought together this fantastic platform. I missed yesterday's webinar, but this is an equally interesting and opportune moment for me to add my thoughts. So I think that a couple of points. One is that I think communication and science communication kind of go together, because I have felt from my own role as a communicator that the better your communication of a particular science article or a scientific work is, it actually means that you have understood or grasped the concepts of that article better. That makes, it's a kind of a two-way process, I would say, but I think understanding the scientific concept makes you communicate better. On the other hand, I think communication, as Nazia said, as Priyanka said, a lot of people have said already, that communication is something that is not a skill that is, Shanti also said, that it's not a skill that is really, ingrained in the Indian education system. So what happens is, in a lot of SciComm positions that are formalized in institutes, you are expected to have a great grasp on science. You are expected to have a great grasp on mass comm techniques. Kind of communication you are expected to basically straddle a lot of fields. And I think there should be a mechanism to formalize collaborations between SciComm experts who are from across disciplines, so that, the science communication is far more effective than it is currently.
Thanks for that, Debarshini. That's a very valid point. I want to raise one more point, which I think Sarah had made earlier about, so playing the devil's advocate, if scientists are being trained to communicate and if journalists, science journalists are being trained to, communicate science better, do we actually need science communicators separately? So just playing the devil's advocate, I'm not saying, that's not my personal opinion. Sarah, would you like to elaborate more on this if you're here? I'm not sure if you're here.
Hi, Siddharth.
Hi.
And this is a question that I have received from a couple of people, that, especially I think because at India Alliance, we are doing these two activities quite actively. So this is a question that we received, that you're training scientists, you're advocating for scientists to become better communicators, to make their science more accessible. And then you're also trying to develop and implement interventions that would improve coverage of science in the media. So, do you really need separate cadre of science communicators? So this is, it's a very good question. I think something that we all need to really reflect upon. But like yesterday, we discussed that science communication is a multi-stakeholder, multidisciplinary process. It is not just one person. It's not centered around just one person. So I guess that would be one of the arguments that we could give, that is why we need multidisciplinary teams to kind of push this forward. And at institutions, particularly when scientists are expected to be to liaise with media, to do all the kind, to do these science education communication activities, is it really fair to put so much of this. I think Somdatta had a point on that as well. I think Sarah, I would like to hear other views on this really before I say anything further.
I think that's a very valid point, Sarah. If anybody would like to add on to her, please raise your hand. Meanwhile, I have a comment to make. So I think what Sarah has said is very important, and something that Madhu and KBB and other people have also written in the chat is that science communication is not just about marketing scientific research within institutions or even marketing the research institutions itself. It's much more than that, right? And there are multiple roles of science communicators in society. So something that Venkat Srinivasan from NCBS has written to us via email, I just wanted to bring in his comment, is that a science communicator can also be seen as sort of a watchdog for science or an interrogator for science, which also questions science, keeps a tab on what's happening, and you know, holds scientists accountable. And the role and the extent and the scope of how to do this and whether we should be doing it or not is a question for further deliberation. But I just wanted to bring in this point that there are multiple roles of science communicators besides just talking about research that's happening. And I think that's something that TVB also mentioned in the comments. Would anybody like to comment on this? I can see Somdatta has raised a hand. Somdatta, please.
Hi, such an interesting point to talk about. So I agree that this happens with any kind of job, because any job will keep on evolving and the face of that role will keep on changing. So what our role might look like today might not remain the same 5 years later. So the answer to the question is probably going to be yes and no. And I think we need to be agreeing to this fact that if science communication goes the way we want it to go, then our roles will keep changing. And if we are in a position which lets us evolve with time, then we are in a good space. What is going to be a bad space is that we are not let to grow and keep on updating ourselves, our skills, our thoughts, our ideas with time, and then we can become obsolete.
Right. Thank you for that insight, Somdatta. I see that Aarti has been making some very wonderful points in the chat box. Aarti, would you like to come on and speak a little bit and share your thoughts too with us? I think you need to unmute yourself, Aarti.
Yeah. Am I audible now?
Yeah,
I feel that our education system, especially for science and technology, pays absolutely no attention to the language and the communication part. At least, you know, in some engineering colleges, you probably have a course or two on communicating, or you may have to give a seminar or something. But I'm not sure if our basic science courses cover any form of, communication. So I feel just doing science may not be, a complete thing. You need to communicate to various people at various levels. So including that in the formal education will definitely help. So we may not target all people to be effective communicators, but at least they will be sensitized to the fact that a skill is necessary. And, this is what it takes to communicate.
Thank you for sharing that. One more point to add here would be that even the way we teach science, even though we may not be teaching communication skills per se, but even the way we teach science can, has a huge scope for improvement. For example, if in the teaching of science we incorporate the history and philosophy of science, if we use the history and philosophy of science while teaching science itself, it really encourages people to think about the process of science as science being, a structured and formalized system rather than the serendipitous or, sort of an apple falling on your head. It does not really happen all the time in science. I mean, serendipity is important, but a lot of the time it's sheer hard work in science that leads to something, right? So I think teaching the process of science, how to, think about scientific thinking and scientific mindsets, there's a huge scope for, incorporating that within a scientific teaching. And I think that also has a huge influence on how people think about and communicate science much later when they become graduate students or scientists themselves, right? So I see someone has raised their hand. Archita has been waiting for a while. Archita, would you like to make a comment?
Yeah, one of my points is that we are talking about science communication reaching out to the people in general, but within the scientific community, especially Indian journals and even many of the international journals, they are still not written or communicated in a manner in which they can communicate across disciplines. It can't be like a physics paper cannot be understood by a biology person and vice versa. So how do we tune our journals in such a manner that they become understandable across disciplines, so that we promote more interdisciplinary science? In fact, science communication should go beyond and promote science, promote the doing of science. So more of interdisciplinary science, that is one point. And apart from that, science communication in our country is still regarded as a skill. It is still a skill that needs, and people needs to be trained into it. We talk about communication in terms of training only. It's still not regarded as an academic discipline. That is why the academic discourse in our country on science communication is very limited. I think science communication can mature in our country if the academic discourse is much more. And if you look at the administrative structure, UGC still does not recognize science communication as a discipline. So nobody can still have a PhD in science communication. Even if they are doing something in science communication, they have to go via journalism, etc. So that is looking at the mindset and the administrative structure, that is a very important milestone that we need to keep, like recognizing or promoting academic science communication as an academic discipline. So those are the key points. Yeah.
Right. And as the next layer to this discussion, maybe we could also deliberate upon what are the tools that we require for the said skill, right? The skill that is science communication, and how can we enable that? So maybe we can take the conversation towards that. And if anybody would like to add in their personal experiences as sci-commerce, what are the skill sets or what are the tools that they thought, if they were trained in early on, would have definitely helped them sort of smoothly sail through?
To add to Vanshika's point, just a point that I would like to add to what Vanshika said is that as science communicators, do you think there is some sort of a professional development skill that you would like to learn or would like to have resources to learn about? So in terms of continuous professional development, as science communicators, practitioners of science communication, do you think there's something that you would want to learn, and is there a way we can enable that? So if you have any thoughts on that, please share. Yes, Priyanka, please.
Am I audible now? Okay. Yes. So one of the things that you mentioned about skills, and so I'd just like to share a small anecdote about when I was working with Vikram Sarabhai Science Center, and I was working to communicate science in a lot of aspirational districts in Gujarat. So my job would entail me going to a lot of government schools with students who did not have that much means or access to scientific knowledge, and explaining joy of science, which the program was called, to them. But the major thing that none of my science communication training helped me do was speak their language, because I didn't have that means. And so the program was, so technically the students should have understood Hindi or English, but the fact remains that when you're communicating such important topics, it's always better that you communicate in a way that is understandable by the people who are receiving that education. So I had to learn. So I thought, like, even despite me communicating in English, I thought it was best to just pick up the language, and not just the language, say Gujarati, but like the vernacular or the dialect that they speak in, because it makes it so much more easier for someone to grasp concepts. Because that's the thing I think we forget, that when we're given books and we're given a scientific syllabus to follow, a lot of it is lost in wording and scientific terminology. And when we have to convey the concepts, that so while trying to remember those specific terminology without which you might not get the marks needed, I think we lose time in explaining the concepts. And language becomes a huge thing, or I don't know how this might be possible, but I think we as science communicators need to think about using language, using more skills in language to communicate better to localized sections as well.
Thank you for that, that very, very valuable insight. So I would like to move on to something a little bit further. So we can think of science communication as also an activity or an effort to sort of bridge the experiential and informational gap. So different kinds of people, different kinds of stakeholder may differ in the kind of information they have or they have access to and the kind of experiences they have, right? So I'm trying to bring our conversation towards, you know, what is the importance of lived-in expertise in science communication and for science communicators to incorporate that element of, you know, understanding your audience better, as was just mentioned by the previous participant. But also, how do we make science communication more participatory by incorporating our audience's informational and experiential, you know, sort of backgrounds, right? Right, so would anybody like to make a comment on that? Yeah.
I think Aarti has a comment on the line that you mentioned, Siddharth. Sure. Maybe Aarti would like to come in and speak.
Yeah. So this is about talking and languages, right? So one is the actual language, that is whether Marathi, Hindi or Gujarati or whatever. And the other is, you know, putting what appeals to them. Or so I think TVV in the comments has said this in much better words than I said, actually. So he says that we need to understand the culture, you know, and understand the folklore so that we can relate to them better. So he has put in words what I would have liked to say, actually. So we need to relate to them is what I said.
On that note, can we invite TVV to please share his thoughts also? I think he's been commenting a lot of stuff and we hadn't got a chance to get to it. TVV, would you like to make a comment?
Yeah, it's okay. Yeah. That's not the point. I mean, yeah. See, first is, I think we are looking at, when we talk about training, I mean, we are looking at multiple kinds of communicators, not just one kind of communicator. So when we talk about training, if we again focus only on science writing, then we'll be very limited. What about somebody who can make a film? What about somebody who can perform, a folk dance? Yeah. So multiple ways of communication is possible. Multiple communication setups are possible. So I think we need to keep that in mind. Not only possible, they are desirable. That is number one. Number two, when we are asking about some of the desirable qualities or aspects which needs to be kept in training, what do we mean by science communication? We need to examine. I'm not going to go into a very detailed part, but if the science communication is not merely marketing, even if there are some aspects of it, if it has to be some kind of a cultural experience, you know, something like you reading a poetry, you watch a nice film, if it has to be like that a cultural experience, then whatever the communication medium is, whether it is writing or visual or whatever form it is, it needs to have a cultural aspect. So meaning that the communicator should know beyond science and technology. Let's say the audience folk tales, maybe ethos which are present there. One may agree with it or disagree with it. A communicator can have their own view. That's a different issue. I'm not saying that you need to peddle whatever that so-called within quotes people believe. That's not the point. But you need to understand these things. Your reading should be much wider. So this narrowly thinking that a science communicator should be a specialist in science would not be enough. That's what one point that I was trying to make.
I completely agree with you that, you know, science communicators need to have a sort of a breadth of knowledge more than a depth of knowledge, because that's what scientists are for. And you can always, you know, use them as resources to learn more. But I think a science communicator needs to have a much more wider net of, you know, access to information and, you know, cultural practices. So on the note of when you spoke about, you know, incorporating culture, I think it's also very important to incorporate local and hyper-local context. So oftentimes when we are doing any kind of science communication activity, it's very, very important to understand where our audience is coming from, who are our audiences, what are their motivations to engage with us, right? It's not just our motivation to do the science communication. It's also equally important to understand why would the audience actually come and engage with us? What's in it for them, right? So I think this is something a lot of science communicators don't really think about as much as they should. So on that note, I wanted to know if anybody had a comment on, you know, using local and hyper-local context for improving our science communication. I see Divarshini has her hand up. Divarshini, would you like to speak?
Yeah, hi, Siddharth. So I would like to just say that, as you said, it is very important to gauge the audience in order to, you know, project your science communication effort better. Because, you know, no matter how much effort you put into your initiative or your program, if the audience is not able to, you know, grasp that or is not interested in that, then the effort basically falls through. I mean, for example, I would just say that, you know, for this is just an off example that, you know, I work in a particular entrepreneurship ecosystem, and in that ecosystem, you know, I may be, you know, as a science communicator, you may be extremely interested in the scientific workings of a particular innovation. But, you know, an investor, for example, may not be very interested in the deep science of that particular idea. For what matters more is that where, you know, how communicable that idea is, how, you know, easily that can be scaled or how easily that can reach society. So it depends on, you know, where exactly and how you are going to gauge your audience and who is interested in what part of your work. It becomes very important to tune your communication effort to that.
Right. Thank you so much, Divarshini. I think that's a very important point. And I think that also sort of, so because we need to have awareness about a diversity of context and local context, it's one way to do that is actually to have a diversity of science communicators itself, right? Science communicators from different backgrounds, different religion, caste, whatever. I mean, all different kinds of diversity. So I think that very nicely leads us to our next theme, which I think we should move on to because it's 6:30. So let's move on to talking about diversity, inclusivity, equity, and accessibility in science communication. Would anybody like to make a comment before we get on? I think Priyanka has some points. Okay, before we move on to Priyanka, sure. Priyanka, would you like to make a comment?
Yeah, no, I was just, the previous speaker made it, like, he spoke it very well, spoke about it very well, about having that cultural diversity even within the science communicators itself. And I just wanted to add the point that a huge part of it is trust, of establishing trust within the audience. And I think when we become, when we veer towards more of inclusivity and diversity and inclusion, that is a major point, because we can either, again, become people who talk about these diverse people, or but that's again a very othering factor. We have to recognize the fact that we ourselves are very diverse. I mean, even in this small member chat, there are so many people from various different backgrounds, and that's the strength. That's the strength instead of a loop, instead of a barrier, I think. And we need to celebrate that. And by bringing the so-called cultural context, which TVV very correctly pointed out, by acknowledging those cultural diversity within ourselves when we communicate the science, or say the institutionalized form of science, we also kind of bring that into the bigger discourse and we normalize being diverse. So yeah,
That's a great point. Would anybody like to comment on how do we ensure that we build trust within the processes of science communication? Anybody wants to make a comment on how do we build trust within SciComm? I see Anita Nagarajan has commented. Would you like to make a comment, Anita?
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, Anita.
Hi, Siddharth. Yeah, so in the case of some scientific communication projects, what we've seen is that when we partner with somebody from that audience, and that person is the messenger, right? It is received very well by the audience, because then they know that it's one of them or somebody who has benefited from something that we have provided. And that kind of a messenger who is part of the audience makes the trust barrier it makes go away, the barrier go away, and establishes a strong sense of trust. And it helps in building a stronger engagement with our audience.
Right. And while we think about sort of expanding and being like the science communicators being one of them, or collaborating with people within communities, it's also important to address how do we maximize the reach in itself, and what are the medias through which we should be able to sort of bridge the divides that we have in, say, rural urban areas and so on. So maybe we can take the conversation there, and if anybody would have inputs in on those lines.
I also saw that Somdatta made a comment about incorporating local leaders. Somdatta, would you like to elaborate on that? I think that's an important consideration, and it's also important for building trust.
So it's only a thought that I have, and not really a concrete plan. But the more I think about this, I feel that science communicators also become facilitators in context and in very localized contexts. So in my ideal world, I would like that we reach out to the leaders in those smaller communities, and those leaders are empowered then to take it forward. Because otherwise, how many languages, how many modus operandi can one practically be able to take forward is what I get generally overwhelmed by. But then probably somebody has a better way of thinking around it.
I think Tejaswini would like to sort of add her comments about the media that we can use to increase our outreach. Tejaswini, can we have you online?
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah. So I was thinking, like, instead of, you know, just out of the blue going and just randomly in a month just telling them stuff, like, if we start incorporating science, like, as a part of their life, like I mentioned, like, say someone, local communities into block printing or weaving or whatever. So in those places, we have motives that are, you know, science inspired. It doesn't have to be hardcore science, but just a little bit of science inkling, then I think the community will start becoming a little more open to when someone comes and gives you a little more information, you know. So right. That way also, like, you can involve your local leader, get that through. So again, when a bigger youth comes, then they'll be more accepting.
Right. Could I ask people to put their phones on silent? Thank you.
Nasia, would you like to come up next? Because I think you have a thought that's not so much on lines with making political leaders a part of this process. So would you sort of give us your thoughts on that?
Yeah. So basically, I personally believe that the communicators themselves should be dealing with the people, because of course when you're going to a leader, the leader always has a political inclination, or they have a bias, and people perceive them in a certain way, that whatever they would say, they would be saying it with that bias. If a scientist or a communicator themselves go and approach people, it would at least remove that bias or that political leaning or whatever is associated with leaders, and make it more of about science rather than anything else. I'm not sure how this can be approached, because obviously it's very difficult for you to just go out there in the field and communicate with people. But we can always.
But I think it's a pertinent point when we're talking about decentralizing the procedure. I think it's a very pertinent point there. So thank you for bringing that in.
I see Koligala has made a point about, you know, that there's great trust in scientists, and, you know, there should be a way for science communicators to leverage that. Koligala, welcome to the conversation. Would you like to make a comment? you need to unmute yourself, Polipilla. All right, while we wait for Koligala, let me see if there's any other person who's made a comment. Sejal makes a great point about that trust is also built by empathy. Would you like to expand on that, Sejal? I think it's a great point.
Mm-hmm. Hi. Hi. Just to also, I think there's a gap to also bridge for audiences who we expect to understand what we're trying to talk about. I mean, our aim is, of course, to make them understand that certain actions, certain policies might be harmful, or certain creatures that we're trying to protect need their attention. But also to acknowledge that this person has an entirely different life. So, I mean, to bring it to a Bombay, as you said, local example, I mean, look at our lives in Bombay. This person is not during COVID, but like pre-COVID, we are struggling in local trains. Mm-hmm. Like life is survival. Mm-hmm. And then at the end of the day, I don't want to actually rain down on this person by telling them that, look what you're doing and look what you're doing to the universe and look. And they say, I don't care. I don't have the time. So I think it's also nice to understand that, acknowledge that, that gap that, yes, I understand you have a slightly different life. And maybe it is then the responsibility of a communicator to make it palatable and understand that different audiences will want different things. So for example, like I said yesterday, even at Marine Life of Mumbai, sometimes a SciComm post is a SciComm post, like it is a detailed post about the biology of the creature. But at some points, we want to have our audience to have a little fun. So we also do like an emoji game or a poetry showcase and talk about marine creatures in poetry. And I think that there's an audience for everything. I think they're very well-meaning. We just need to bridge that gap with a little empathy. Yeah, that's it.
Thank you so much, Sejal. I think that's a great point. And I think it's very important for us to not only acknowledge, you know, what our audiences want, but also acknowledge the kind of diversity of, you know, people we deal with and, you know, their motivations for doing this. Right. So shall we move on to the next point? I think Koligala is here.
Yeah. It was a great point that we need to look up to the leaders of the community leaders to help us. But then we need to also be very careful about the belief systems that might be interfering with their, you know, understanding of science or our understanding of their, you know, behavior. So this is very important. And one of the things that I would always like to keep away is the politics, because they have an agenda. Whereas the other community leaders may not have an agenda. So we have to be very careful about that. I can cite an example here recently, when during the COVID, when we were all struggling to communicate about the disease and its, modes of transmission and other things. Okay. We found the local leaders, you know, using the opportunity and spreading a lot of myth. It was very difficult for us to counter that. Not necessary that we need to counter, but even when the people said that, yes, this is what is happening. So to make them understand that that is not reality is very difficult. So we should be very careful about these kind of pressures that are around us when we are trying to communicate. So one way is to, like TVV many times says that we need to be very careful when it comes to the belief systems. Don't counter. But if it is possible to lead them from that to the rational, that will be fantastic. So, but that needs a lot of patience, that needs a lot of understanding of the system in which we are working.
Absolutely. I think that needs a lot of time and, you know, willingness to kind of understand who you're working with. So I also wanted to sort of phrase this question to everyone. Is that how do we better acknowledge this, acknowledge the difference that exists within the Indian system? So in the Indian context, we have multiple challenges. There is the challenge of, you know, scaling everything up in science communication. There's also the challenge of different languages. But there's also challenges of, you know, our audiences having very different socio-cultural background. For example, if you take any village versus any urban audience, there's a huge difference in how we approach and how we do science communication, right? So how do we sort of acknowledge these differences better and kind of redesign or sort of morph our science communication activities to address these things? Would anybody like to make a comment? I see Manasvi has raised her hand. Go on, Manasvi.
Hello.
I don't know why there is a lack of many newspapers here, but I feel like that is where a lot of rural and urban families and people get the information, especially science information from, and where it is quite repetitive, most likely from, you know, not Indian sources, and it is not as engaging as the as good SciComm is done in Indian online, you know. So I feel like having a better SciComm articles that will be published in newspapers is a good way to go. Local newspapers in Telugu and Kannada, and also mainstream English newspapers, having good SciComm articles in there.
Thank you for that, Manasvi. I think that also raises a very important question as to what is the impact of the format or medium or platform that we use for science communication. For example, if we are communicating something on a digital or social media platform, it's often inaccessible to people who cannot read, and it's inaccessible to people who don't have electronic devices. So how do we sort of, you know, acknowledge the existence of different kinds of platforms and channels to communicate, and what's the impact that using different channels have? Devanshini, yes.
Can I?
Sure, go ahead.
Yeah, what I do here is that I use all the media, okay, all the platforms, social platform as well as the print and audio or visual. Okay, but each platform addresses a different audience. So if I am posting something on Twitter, and I usually do it in English because my audience is different, and if I have them to put on WhatsApp, we have several groups where it spreads very fast. And with my peer groups, I use my Facebook. So this is something that I use for communicating, and this works very well. This works very well, especially. And for writing, of course, you have the print media as well as your, you know, the blog or your Facebook. Oh, so I use all these platforms simultaneously to communicate.
That's a great point about using different platforms for different audiences and different purposes. I see Priyanka has raised her hand. Go on, Priyanka.
Yeah, just a short point there, adding to what he said just now, and I think that's a very valid point about using a lot of platforms. But also, I think I think Aarti mentioned in one of the comments that a lot of the local newspapers do carry good science-based articles, and I've seen that happen in Marathi, Bengali, Gujarati, and I'm sure there are many other local languages which do incorporate a lot of these fantastic SciComm articles. I think, but as you also earlier mentioned, that it kind of stays circulated within an audience which is already aware and does not reach an audience that needs that kind of extra push. So I was just wondering, one of the ways, and this is by no means the only way, but one of the main ways to have that involvement by, say, a more a different audience is crowdfunding. So crowdfunding sources can allow, and not just crowdfunding in terms of money, but also in terms of opinion articles or opinion bases or anecdotal stories from the people that we are trying to communicate to. So when we communicate with instead of communicating to, it becomes something that the local audiences are much more interested in and invested in, rather than it circulating within the same group that is producing it.
Thanks for that, Priyanka. I think it's a very valid point, and at the core of your point is that, you know, we make SciComm more participatory, which is what you mean by communicating with and not to, which is not being condescending to people. Can I move on and sort of bring in the visual communicators, because I think the platform that we choose for doing science communication has a huge impact on the access and reach to our messages that we're trying to communicate. So would any visual communicators or people who do podcasts, for example, or multimedia communicators, would you like to share any anecdotes or personal experiences of using multimedia platforms, which is infographics, graphics, art, illustrations, podcasts, videos, or any other kind of multimedia platform? Would anybody want to make a comment on that? I think it's important that we discuss the format that we use for doing science communication and the impact it has on access and reach also. Yes, Debashi. Can I call Ipsa first? Yes, Ipsa.
Yeah, hi. So So it's not so much multimedia, but I do create visuals, and I've been creating zines a lot. I've created some in collaboration with Somdata, some in collaborations with the Simon Center, and some of my own independent work too. And at least in my own independent work, what I end up doing is that I use very little words, and it's mostly based on visual metaphors and science-inspired imagery. And having presented that at like the Bangalore Comics Festival, which is maybe an audience where scientists and science students don't come, I have been able to, you know, break that barrier across language and across expertise. So so it's been so images are great way to cross barriers of language and expertise, both like science literacy and language.
While you think about these new sort of mediums, it also sort of helps to get back to the old school ways of communicating, right? And Ananda here has a point about, you know, how about having like a mandatory AIR news bulletin compulsory every day that brings out science news. So would you like to elaborate on that, Ananda?
Hello?
We can hear you. Yeah.
Okay, great. Thank you. I can say that in my childhood, I was waiting to listen afternoon science programs in radio. Mm-hmm. And that was the precise reason that after being professionals also, I thought of communicating wonders of science to social media. My platform called S3N3 reaches a single news can reach 50,000 people. So that was my point, basically, that the simplest method can reach the largest number of people.
Yep.
So that is why I was telling that if it is compulsory, that one at least small science news every day, they can make it mandatory. Now public is appreciating science more than ever because the doctors are necessary to create the vaccine.
Mm-hmm.
If something starts like that, one news, whatever field it is, from DST, Vigyan Prasar, whatever it is, then they one single sentence. Create the message. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
That's it.
Priyanka has a point about science slams. I'm sorry, did I interrupt anybody?
Can I add to Hota's this one? Okay,
sure.
I have actually put in the text also there. All India Radio has these programs and they are very wonderful. But the thing is, All India Radio has several other programs also to cater to, and therefore the space available will be very limited. And secondly, sometimes the reach may not be the perfect. I have tried with FM. I have also tried with All India Radio several times. There are some limitations. So what we can do is that we can explore the community radios that are available around the country, and there are many hundreds. One of the plus point is that the community radios are always short of content. So if we can provide them the content, and that will be one of the ways that we can do. And secondly, it also gives us a lot of chance to reach to the community directly, because each community radio caters to a specific community, and therefore the modes of communication can be suitably tailored, and we can reach them out. And this is one of the things. And the podcast that, this is to Mr. Hota, that this was one of the problem why I started podcast. And the podcasts are now sent through WhatsApp and also distributed through community radio. So that way they reach a larger audience and a targeted audience. And there was a question about how do we cater to or get interested, or what kind of community gets interested in science communication. Yes, I also had a sort of a idea that, you know, when we start talking in Kannada, it will be only the people who are interested in learning in Kannada medium. But to my surprise, I have subscribers from IT industry, from the bureaucracy, from teachers, and the housewives. So it's a wide range. The difficulty is, how do I normalize the communication, normalize the language to cater to all of them? It's a great challenge. Sometimes, we tend to go overboard and communicate to one type of people, maybe my peer group, but then to forget that and keep all these audience in mind is a very, very difficult thing. All India Radio may be doing, but All India Radio has a different approach. So they have slots which are different. Okay, so I know that there is a science program, and so if I'm interested in science, I can listen to that. But for my audience, that is not available. So that, these kind of challenges will be there.
Right. Priyanka, you were making a point earlier about science slams, right? And we can also think about, beyond widening the reach, of course, we could also think about how engagement is one way of really enriching the experience of SciComm for the people at the receiving end. So would you like to give us some anecdotal experiences about that?
Yes. I was just making a prompt rather than a point. So science slams are so science slams are basically short, 3 minute to 10 minute non-lecture type lectures, not lecture types, series or talks given by scientists or people working within the science community to a general audience or a mixed audience, which might include scientists, might include non-scientists, might include absolute industry people, but communicating essentially in a way that is understandable for all and incorporating creativity and fun. So that was just me trying to introduce science slams as an option for other people. So right now, the engagement that you speak of, and I think podcasts, science illustrations, radio shows that Ananda was speaking about, and these become huge valuable resources for not just to gain information. I think there's also this enjoyment that one receives from these activities, right? And I think that becomes a huge, huge essential thing. Sometimes we forget that education should be enjoyed as well. And so one of the things that I, and so if you would, anecdotal experience, one of the things that I did was there was this wonderful, wonderful project by Government of India called Science Express, which was a 16-coach long train that went around India with in each state, stopping at different locations. And I was there for some time. And we had to, every day we were speaking in different languages. We didn't know which language we would speak next. But the huge benefit of that was that we would have around 30 to 40,000 people every day coming in to watch and enjoy science education. And the phase that I was, and the phase that I was in, was in, was called Climate Change Action Special.
I'm sorry, could you unmute yourself?
But the fact remains that the lesson that I learned was that people are interested. It's not that people might not be interested, or I thought that only people who are really interested in science will come to visit, but everyone came. If we make it enjoyable, some people might get hooked with the enjoyment and realize that science is not this subject to be feared, and it finds application in many other ways. And a very interesting way to do that, you, as you said, is engagement rather than just having lecture series. So so one of the other things that I would want to tag is I found this really nice lecture series, I think hosted on YouTube by IIT Gandhinagar, and there are many such more reservoirs of information that are already there on YouTube, and it's really interesting what this platform has made available to us.
Thank you so much for making that point, Priyanka. I think an important consideration that you've raised is that science communication is not just done for educating people. It can also be done for enjoyment, for fun, for, you know, engaging in something for the sake of engaging in it. And so I think these are important considerations and motivations that we should take into account while designing more science communication activities. I wanted to sort of bring everybody's attention to another aspect. And I'll come to the people who raised their hands. So there's this concept called science capital, which basically encompasses what is a person's surrounding, who are they exposed to, do they have access to people who do science, do they actually have access to knowledge about scientific attitudes, are they actually being enabled to form attitudes towards science. And so all of this is basically an abstract collective entity of the social, cultural, economic, all kinds of aspects that, you know, surrounds us, right? And so in India, it's very interesting. And so the concept of science capital was first introduced by researchers at King's College London. And I think it's important, it's very interesting to think about that in the Indian context, because in India, the concept of science capital is just, you know, it just blows apart, right? So would anybody like to make a comment on that? And while we think about that, can I invite Tejaswini, who's raised her hand? Yes, Tejaswini.
Hi. So I wanted to make a point about how you spoke about using science communication, not just for education, but curiosity too. So I just want to give an example. Like, as part of my coursework, there was this wax sculpture we had to make showing the facial muscles. Now, that was just the brief, and at least half the figure was supposed to be that. So once that was done, the other half is something that I made, like the face of an Indian goddess. Now, the purpose of that was to educate medical students and dental students in their first year to understand the muscular structure of the face. But then, because the sculpture had a different aspect where, you know, you show an expression and there's a different color or whatever, it was very fascinating, and a video was made, and that was used by the university as a PR thing to, you know, gather public and the local community to come and see the actual medical art exhibition. So it's not like, because art exhibitions are fascinating, but when you start involving a lot of science and details, the thing is, you know, it's very textual and too complex for them to understand. But then when a video was made, so it's the same sculpture, a video is made and then it's put out. And then with the same thing, just an image was taken and, you know, an article was written up about it. No, like, scientific jargon going into it. You're not naming the muscles, but you're using that same one object to put across so many messages and to gather so many different crowds. So I think something like that, like here again, like someone else previously mentioned, that we're always talking about communicating your own research. That shouldn't be the only aim. Like, you should also look into gathering more people into science, like getting more people interested in science. And also, like, these students who are expected to communicate science, I feel they also should be exposed to science that's communicated in a fascinating manner, like in their teaching process, you know, in their daily classes, the first 2 years when you have your coursework. In that coursework, you should incorporate science communication. So there's like a natural liking that develops to, you know, put across your work also like that in the future.
Absolutely.
Hello. We are not able to hear you.
Hello.
The microphone is muted.
Sorry, I'm so sorry. I didn't realize. I was just saying that thanks for sharing that, Tejaswini. I see that Kulagala has also raised his hand. Kulagala, would you like to speak for a minute?
Oh, have I raised my hand? Oh, I didn't know. Okay, anyway. Right.
Okay, let's move on. So I think, does anybody have a comment on thinking about the social cultural context in of our audiences? Yes, Tejaswini, again. All right, I think that was a mistake.
Yeah. Can I?
Yeah,
it
sure.
Is, it's always very important that we know these sociocultural aspects. Okay, I'll just give an example of what I faced in one of the classes where, you know, I was to teach them in Kannada about the nervous system. So usually what happens is that we take the textbook and teach whatever is there. So when I started teaching, this is the 10th standard students in Kannada, about the brain, the words that we use for brain, like mastishka or midulu, it didn't make, you know, elicit any response in them. Nothing. I was talking to a group of tribal children. So I just stopped and then started talking to them about what they eat and all these things. And then I asked them whether they eat the, we call it as tale mamsa, that means the brain. Okay, so that is the meat that they eat. So when I broached that topic, there was an excitement, a lot of excitement and a lot of discussion about how it looks, what it happens, and the texture, and all these things were immediately seen, because they catch birds and eat the birds and the bird brain and everything. So this was something that I learned. So I have to, if we have to communicate, there can be a normalized system. And then if you have a specific audience, then please look at their socio-cultural background, their understanding of their world. And if you can enter that world, then it will be easier to communicate. Otherwise, it will be difficult. And that is one of the aspects. Because whatever I may be speaking about here, for a sociologist, my, these words might mean something different. And maybe Siddharth will take it in a different way. And so therefore, we need to first understand the audience and then communicate to them. And this is a challenge for anybody in any media.
Yeah, I think that's a great point. And I think it draws us back to what I said earlier about, you know, sort of acknowledging and respecting lived-in expertise. So just to continue the conversation, I'll share an example. For example, if someone has a critical sort of a congenital disease, for example, that person as a patient of that disease has a very different understanding of living with that disease. So that kind of knowledge is important. On the same hand, a doctor which is treating that patient has a very different kind of medical knowledge about the disease, and his inputs are equally important. And on the same hand, a scientist who is researching about the disease has a very scientific kind of information or knowledge about that same condition, right? And we're talking about, say, something called diabetes, for example, right? And so these are all important facets and different forms of knowledge. I'm not equating all of the three forms as equivalent or as important, but I think when we are engaging people with science, it's very important for us to acknowledge and respect the different kinds of knowledge that people have with them just by the virtue of living their lives, which is called lived-in expertise. And I think it's very, very important for us to kind of respect and acknowledge lived-in expertise when we are designing any kind of science engagement activity, because that really enables us to connect for them to also kind of have a draw-in or a buy-in into our science engagement activity, and for us to also better understand their context, social, cultural, economic, whatever, all the context put together. So I think just taking on from Koligala's comment, I just wanted to make this comment that it's important for us to kind of acknowledge and respect different kinds of expertise and kind of respect people. And if we do it respectfully, we also build trust, we also become more transparent. But we also have this humility around us, which kind of makes our science communication endeavors much more useful and effective, right? So that's one comment I had. All right. So does anyone have any comment on this note? Does anyone have a comment on how do we democratize science and access to knowledge better?
Yes. Hi.
Hi.
Yeah. I have a comment regarding contextualizing science communication. Regarding that, could we create more icons who could communicate? I mean, instead of us communicating, because we going into a community and communicating is a different thing. And if we can create icons who can communicate, create in the sense, I'm not talking about picking up people, that is one method definitely, but we can create characters who can go and communicate. One example is from Roald Dahl, who had created an octopus, and that octopus communicated about environmental movements in their country. So can we have equivalents to that, making science communication more conversational? So we can have icons in every language, every context, every cultural context. So they can be much more appealing, that rather than we going and speaking something, and they can come out, people can come out more and talk to them in that manner.
I think that's a very valid point. Thank you, Dr. Bhatta. I think that also brings us to the importance of using stories and narratives, as you mentioned. Yeah. So using these icons is basically another form of stories, characters, narrative. So would anybody like to, you know, make a comment on that?
I think we can invite IPSA.
Sure.
Yeah. That limits us to a few media, probably, the icons. So how do we do for direct engagement? Direct engagement, you need a different aspect.
Also,
yeah,
we can also tell a story through a podcast, actually. So
yeah. So take, what take we can
what she said. I mean, the icons is just.
I got it. Got it. Yeah. So that's one thing. But we also need an icon for science. We lack that in India. I have been talking about this for the last 15 years. So somewhere we had Abdul Kalam, but now he is gone. So we need to have an icon. We don't have.
We need several, not one.
Yeah,
we lack icons.
We need, yes. So we can create this. Yeah, this is a great idea. Okay, let me experiment that with that in my podcast and see how it works out. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Yes, Kalinda, I have some examples of that I can share with you, and you could experiment with those. I mean, existing
stories.
Yeah, I see that Priyanka has made a comment about, you know, using live stories and live theater. And I can cite an example of the jathas, which happened in the 1980s and 1970s, where people, these science communicators, the sort of, I mean, nobody really talks about them, but there were these group of people who did theater and called jathas, who went around villages in India and talked about lots and lots of scientific and developmental issues. And I think that was a great example of, you know, science communication at the grassroots levels. And I think we should really think about, you know, these kind of examples and how we can bring them in. I see Anita has made a point. Anita, would you like to comment on how we can use real stories within SciComm?
Hi, Siddharth. Sorry, I don't see a raised hand symbol on my the icon, so I'm just sorry. But yeah, what we did on one project was where we were trying to encourage people to come out and test themselves for TB. There was this whole some kind of fear associated with even coming out and being detected positive. So what happened was we took stories of people from the same community who had trouble first, but who went and who got themselves tested, and the positive outcomes, the way the treatment went, what the treatment did for them. And when these stories of people, familiar people, went to those communities in various forms, everybody was more convinced, more willing to accept the information and the type of science that we were trying to communicate. So when it's real life stories about people they know, it seemed to have a much greater impact than just trying to communicate the science directly.
Okay. Thanks for that. Itza, would you like to share your story about the figs as an example?
Yeah, sure. So during a conference at IISc, we, as a group of scientists and non-scientists, we got together and we performed a dance on ecology of fig. And so that was, dance at that point was our vehicle of storytelling. And it made an extremely emotional impact on the audience. Like, we had audience in tears at some point. And I mean, unfortunately, we were not able to present that, you know, beyond the institutional ecosystem because of lack of support, things that we discussed yesterday. So I think we, SciComm, could be inclusive of all medias and all art forms. And I think, like Archita mentioned about, you know, character-driven storytelling. And I think storytelling can both be character-driven and character-independent, but stories and narratives are what people relate to, and it builds empathy and it builds trust because you start, you know, relating to the narrative. So yeah, that's useful. And with respect to media, somehow, because of the people that are there in the group, we have been talking about writing and illustrations a little bit, but I think, and podcasts, but it can be much, much more than that.
Thank you for that, sir. So I think since in the interest of time, I think let's move on. So I think one more aspect of discussion prompt that we have not yet covered so far is the issue of ethics in science communication. And so would anybody like to, you know, share an anecdote or an insight on how do we incorporate and, you know, sort of evolve discussions around the ethics of science communication? Does anybody have an example or a case study that they would like to share?
I think, Siddharth, while people think about it, Shagun has posed a question here for all of us in the room. That Shagun, would you like to come in and ask it yourself?
Thanks, Vanshika. That was a shocker when you suddenly called the name. But yeah, I'll ask it again. So just thinking from the angle of how to do it now, because there are a lot of points came up, I mean, which I wouldn't have even thought of. Those came up in terms of inclusion in this mm-hmm. whole community of science communication, right? Not just in the way of practicing, but also in the form of engaging with the community groups. I think Kolegila brought lot of anecdotal examples also, but what kind of interventions, policy level interventions, can really address those inclusion issues? Are there any ideas there directly to take it up?
Hello. I think there must be a different system, okay, a little bit away from the, or independent of the government, to drive this. See, I see a problem with the government agencies, like that are now funding or driving these kind of activities. So there will be always a sort of a pressure on them to look at only specific issues or specific aspects, whereas that is not the end of it. Okay, locally there may be other issues that need attention, so those things get overlooked. So it is always important that we create an independent body which looks into this. We had actually other non-profit organizations like BJVS, that is Bharat Gyan Vigyan Samiti, or the NCSTC network, or other things, but somehow that has not worked. So there must be somewhere where I think two things must happen. One, for independent science communicators, resources must be available, must be made available through this. The second thing is driving specific communication efforts, looking at the inclusivity. Okay, the inclusion has both linguistic as well as the cultural aspects. So these are two different. Although we bring language into the cultural aspect, the problem with the language within the system also is within a culture also is very much important. For example, if I am speaking about Kannada, so the general standardized language, or let's talk about Hindi, the general language that is used in science communication or in science writings is not the language that people speak. So there is a gap between the written as well as the spoken, or the written or the understood. So this gap also creates a sort of a non-inclusivity. So this is another aspect. So we need, my strong point is that an independent system is the need of this, and how do we create that is that must happen through the policy.
Right, thank you so much for sharing that, Kolegila. Shagun, do you have a quick point to make? I see your hand raised.
Yeah, thanks Siddharth. Thank you Kolegila for that very insightful response. I just wanted to share one more experience that I came across. We, in the process of STIP 2020, we were also reaching out to so many other platforms, right? We reached out to community radios. I think somebody just spoke about it a while ago. There are 290 community radio stations. I think the National Council for Science and Technology Communication is actually having the databases. And the model for what we are trying to address here, one community radio in very far corner of West Bengal, that person just told me, the one who runs the community radio just told me, like, it is running in a Kisan Kendra center or something. Okay, that's like only three people sitting in a remote village trying to connect with people, and their 2 o'clock program in the afternoon is the hit, because the short range communication within the 6 kilometer, like 4 or 5 smaller villages, they said they don't have much to do, but their 2 o'clock to 3 o'clock program about how to engage, how to use this tool, that tool for their real work, like the scientific communication, there was really, really hit. So models, I think, exist, but just that existing model has to be strengthened and even to be known. I also feel at some level, science communication as a model today in terms of inclusivity is kind of divided in binary. Like, there is a hi-fi urban driven model, and there is also something which they don't really create a lot of noise, but they are sitting in some nook and corner and trying to do. So my thing is MIB, Ministry of Information and Broadcasting, they said that the community radios, really, they don't have fund. Even if you give them 5,000 rupees per month, they are really good. They are happy to do many things. I said, like, 5,000 is not a big money. Why are we not doing it? I said, like, no, that's a good thought. We haven't come up with a program to do that.
Yeah, can I interrupt here?
Can we come back to you? Sorry, I'll just come back to you. I think... So there's one more person. Chavi has made a point about organization of SciComm. Chavi, would you like to speak? We'll come back to you, Kolegila. Sorry.
Hi. So I'm someone who's just dipping their toes in SciComm, to be honest. And, you know, I'm more learning here than contributing. But I have, from my own experience, I've seen that you can put, 10 excellent implementers together in a collaborative effort, and things can go haywire. And this is from my own experience. What makes a difference is someone who can have a more detached and more objective, somebody with the understanding of making very, putting things very objectively in terms of what are the requirements, and of any certain project. Like, it could be anything that requires a collaborative effort towards a certain end. It benefits from someone who can look at it as a non-implementer from a more objective perspective, for getting all those excellent implementers together to work in one direction. Just my two cents, that's it.
Thank you so much for sharing that, Shavi. Before we move on to Koligala, for a very short comment this time, because I think he has spoken enough. I just want to say that what Shagun said about is a perfect example of having local and hyperlocal SciComm. And it's also a perfect example of how things can be very different in urban versus rural settings. So moving on to Koligala, please.
Yeah, I was about to say the same thing about Chagun's comments. And this is a very important thing that we provide. You see, there are two things. One, we can provide either the resources in terms of monetary help, or we can also provide the contents. I have been trying to get a number of these community radios together so that we can distribute the contents that we produce, or devise the contents along with them. Inclusively, so that the science part can be taken up. I see that there is a lot of scope for this. And right now, I am engaged with two community radios. So we can expand this further. And that depends upon how we look at them, because each of them community has a different focus. So therefore, we will have to retailer our contents or our approach to each community radio separately. But that can be done with audio. It can be done very easily, so that's not a difficult thing. So we can do that. So this is one thing. Yeah.
Thanks a lot, Koligala. We'll have to move on. So if anybody wants to, collaborate with Koligala on community radio, or pick his brains on how to go about doing community radio, it would be a great option to get in touch with him. I just wanted to bring back the conversation back to what Shagun said. So we just have 10 minutes left now, and I just wanted to ask if anybody has any other inputs, policy interventions, or policy suggestions for incorporating within science communication. If anybody would like to pitch in with policy suggestions for improving science communication in any of the themes that we've discussed so far. Yeah, Somdatta, yes.
Yeah, so one of the things that I see missing among research institutes is the possibility of multiple institutes coming together to communicate a particular theme. Over and over again, we have been talking about that one scientist, or even oftentimes one institute, cannot bring a holistic picture that is relevant for the non-scientist community. And the most feasible way that we can already start working on is if we can have, let's say, an engineering institute coming on board, a research institute, an exploratory research institute coming on board, a service providing institute coming on board. If they can all come together, it makes a much more complete picture. And at the moment, there is no push for this. There is also pretty much no mechanism for this.
Thanks for making that point, Somdatta. I think it's a very valid concern. To sort of twist this on its head, can I ask people if they would be willing to contribute in any way, and if they would be willing to sort of work towards achieving sort of this multi-institutional collaboration sort of stuff? I think this is a great platform to ask people if they would be willing to pitch in any constructive ways, and if you could get people to write in the chat box what they would be willing to help with, I think that could be a start, right? And Shagun makes a point about, can we also encourage corporate social responsibility CSR funds from big companies towards community radio activity? Sure, definitely. I see a lot of institutions, big institutions in India, actually using CSR fund for SciComm, and I can see the NCBS does that too. All right, Divita, would you like to make a comment on what you've commented in the chat box?
Yeah, I think just to expand on what Saugata was saying, I think that's very true. Even like sometimes in local areas where there are many scientific institutions, like the research happening in one or even like the facts coming out of one institute doesn't really get spread to the next one because they always think about competition. So I think instead of just having like science collaboration, they could also be like talks of collaboration in terms of science communication itself, so that they could be like more like non-competitive way of doing that.
Thank you for that. Is there anyone who has not spoken so far who would like to speak? I think we have a panel on inclusivity, and I think I must ensure that, you know, if people have not spoken yet, they should be given a chance. So this is your chance, the silent, shy people. Would anybody like to make a comment? I know I can call people by name, but I'm not doing that because I don't want to put a spotlight on them. Anyone? All right. So let's move on. So I think I must reiterate that, you know, as a consequence to the discussions that we've had yesterday and today, the SPF, the Science Policy Forum, and the SciConSci Club team will be putting together a draft policy framework. And we are hoping to include everybody who has attended both yesterday's and today's session as contributors. But in the draft document, we won't include anybody's name. We want all of you to have a look at the draft document. And if you do, after reading the draft document, if you feel like you do not wish your name to be included, or if you do not agree with what has been said, you can write to us and say that I do not want my name to be included. So just putting that out before people start leaving. Also, secondly, the draft policy framework would be put out for public feedback. So all of you would be emailed a copy of that. And if there's anything that you would like to change, improve, modify, edit, please let us know. We'll probably be putting out the draft document by Friday, and we'll stop collecting feedback on Monday. I'm sorry, it has to be the weekend, but we have to submit this document by the end of this month to the SGIP process. So we actually just have a week. So I'm just putting this out that we'll be doing this. And if there's any other feedback, please feel free to engage with us on email. You have our email IDs, or on social media. You also know the channels. Is there any last comments anybody would like to make? I think we have 3 minutes left. So before we move on towards the conclusion, anybody would like to make any concluding remarks, any feedback, anything that you would like to say? You can raise your hand. It's an open forum for the next 3 minutes. Right. Yes, Manasvi.
I just wanted to say this is really nice to have everyone here. And is there like a possibility of having like a SciComm convention or something of sorts in which in India, where yearly ones just science communicators meet and discuss and be like, what should we do this year? What has not worked out? And discuss like this, because it's really nice and helpful.
So I think that's an excellent
suggestion. I'm just going to jump in here. Sorry, Siddharth, I couldn't resist this.
Yeah, go on.
Actually, Vanshika came up with this term called SciComm Bharat. Sorry for that.
I can't believe you did that on camera. Okay.
All right. Yep. So after this public embarrassment of Vanshika by Shagun, I have to say that, so because since we'll be preparing a policy draft out of this, that policy draft does not have to be the final draft. It could just be the first iteration. And we can actually keep working on it in the future. So we'll have to submit this to SGIP by the end of this month. But it could be something that we could come back to 6 months later and sort of have another discussion like this virtually, depending on how the COVID situation is. So we could have another virtual discussion. But I think what Manasvi said and what Shagun has also said, I think there's a great scope for having something together. And I think this is also building upon Somdatta's point of, you know, having a multidisciplinary or multi-institutional collaboration. I'm coming to you, Somdatta, just 1 minute. So I think it's a great idea for science communicators across India. And when I say science communicators, not just people like us who are affiliated with institutions and are more visible because of our privilege, but also people who are working in villages, who are working in remote areas, who may not be that well known. I think that all of us should come together in some way or the other and sort of discuss what's the future for science communication. And I think it's been great having all of you guys and having so many diverse voices, diverse expertise, diverse experiences here.
Siddharth has already sort of initiated this SciComm Bharat that Shagun just mentioned, and it, like Ipsa mentions, it will be fruitful if we sort of extend this, you know, this seed of people that we've gathered here and extend this as a group itself, a virtual group that sort of continuously deliberates on for a longer time and for the sustainability of what we have done. So So for sure, I think we
Ipsa has made a comment that I did not think about. So Ipsa says we can all be a part of the Google group or SciComSci Slack group. So the SciComSci Club already has a Slack group which has about, I think, 70 or 80 members, and you're very, very welcome to join the Slack group and, you know, continue the conversation. I'll share the link for the Slack group on our social media channels after the event. Can I come back to Somdatta? You had a point. Sorry. Somdatta?
Actually, Somdatta forgot she had 2 points, and one of them was...
I'm sorry about that.
No, that's okay. So I'm pretty sure it'll come back sometime and put it up on Twitter maybe. But one of the things is... you have already covered, and I think this is a very good time for us to propose in the policy document also for the need of a conference for SciCommerce. And that reminds me, the next point also came. The next point was that increasingly there are conferences abroad now which invite SciCommerce for research conferences, and that culture does not yet exist in India in the fullest form. So that, I mean, so while there should be conference exclusively for ScienceCom people, there should also be provision for ScienceCom people to go and attend research conferences where they get to network with other scientists, and also that becomes another place for people to get a holistic feel for a certain field.
Yeah, I think that's a great point. And yesterday we missed out on covering grants and fellowships for science communicators to attend conferences. And I think that's a very, very important point that, you know, there should be more support, both funding-wise and institutional setup-wise, for science communicators to engage with the global community of science communicators, not just within India, but also in other developing countries, also in more countries of the global south, where the context for doing science engagement is very similar to India. And I think there's a great value in learning from each other. So, that's a very nice point. And I also see Shagun has made a point about having a conclave or sort of a conference within India for science communication. I know for a fact that NISCARE was involved in, and DST was involved in this conference called the Public Communication of Science and Technology, PCST conference, about 10 years ago in 2010, if I'm not wrong. And they did have an international science communication conference in India, but sadly none of us knew about it, and it was not well advertised or publicized. So I think there is a huge scope for, you know, having another of those conferences within India at a regular level. Right. So I think we are almost at the end of our session today. Panchika, would you like to just conclude the session and give the thank you note?
Sure. I mean, you've already put out the fact that we'll be putting out a policy memo where everybody can engage with us further. I think just in interest of time, I'll just sort of acknowledge the team that has enabled this within a short span of time. Like you and I just sort of curating this with Chagun, and then getting on board Farmida, who's you know, managing all the back end, and Yashika, Suchita, and Zile, who've been doing a wonderful job in sort of really helping us get this together. And I hope that it's been fruitful for everybody to join in, and we hopefully will be able to sort of feed all of these and all the pertinent points into the STIP policy process. And thank you everybody for joining in.
Thank you so much. It was really nice having all of you. We'll close the session now. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Oops, we forgot to mention about the photo. It's okay.
Yeah, I think it's okay.
People have already left. I it's fine, I guess.
Okay, fine.
But we had one yesterday. I mean,
can you stop recording, and then we can have the next conversation.